Good evening, and welcome back to Let's Play Leviathan, the last day of the decade. When we left off last time, well, we'd accidentally killed Mitchell Rader, kind of a bummer, and had Edna eat his body. And now we're moving on to investigate the ring that Kale gave us. We're in White Circle District, so gonna track down this jeweler. Let's do it. I do want to take a moment just to say, in case it hasn't come through at all, as I've been playing this playthrough, I am very, very, very much enjoying this. I'm a big reader. Fantasy is my preferred genre. This is hitting just all the right notes for me. I love this. I love the grim aspects to it. I mean, we start off as an 8-year-old boy with a head in a sack, like it's a normal thing. Now we've got Edna following us around. Now we've got a mystical tree showing up and saying, "Don't become an aberration, because you look like you're about to," and then we turn around and kill somebody. I mean, it's pretty fantastic. This is exactly my kind of thing, so I'm very much enjoying this. Let's see what everybody's doing around about here. A lavishly dressed person in red is arguing furiously with an old man in light armor made of leather. Oh, let's listen in. Oliver walks up closer to hear the conversation. "Can't you see that that's not what's happening here? I don't agree with you, you know. However..." "However, when sedition starts to spread into the streets, it becomes the government's business. Isn't that right? Yes?"
"Oh?"
"And there's really no difference of whether it has become the concern of all of Croystam or just one street, because regardless, we need to stop the infection. Immediately, understand? Finger rots? Cut it off. Your hand rots? Cut off your hand. Your head rots, and that's it. It's no laughing matter, agree?" "Well, what's the big deal, guy? What's going on?" "My neighbor Lucretia, she seemed like a quiet, smart, virtuous woman until recently."
"Oh?"
"She buried her husband last year, and now her son has caught the disease, you know. The decade got him. Evenings, you know, I make a brew of St. John's wort, lay down on the couch with a book, and leaf through the pages as I listen to the city. I open the window and listen."
"Oh, you're an eavesdropper, right?"
"I hear a faint noise. It's as if someone is cutting buttons off of clothes, and they're piling on the floor. Not falling, but flying onto the floor with a sharp clink. Clink, clink, clink. So I think to myself, buttons, really? Maybe it's not buttons at all. I go onto the balcony. Our house is built in the courtyard, so you can see the whole yard. I get up, you know, onto the balcony, look into Lucretia's window.
Okay.
And see that she's throwing something onto the floor, passionately throwing it. 'You bitch,' she says. 'You whore. Your father was a bastard, and your mother was a slut who served aberrants, and you're a piece of shit.'
Wow, Lucretia. What is going on?"
I stand there thinking, who made Lucretia so mad? Then I remember the debt. She borrowed money from me for her son's funeral. She borrowed a little, you know, alone. I go up to her. 'Lucretia,' I say, 'I need money, and you owe me. Can you repay me?' She nods and holds out my 5 gold, and there. The coins are all striped and contorted with the king on each of them. Scratched out, the king's eyes. On each of them, with a nail. No, not a nail, but something else, you know. I've never scratched out the king's eyes on coins. Maybe it was a nail.
'Will you show me?'
Aha, some input from this fella. He must be some kind of... Well, he's just... Yeah, I don't think he's a guard, but he's gotta be some kind of government agent, right?
Huh?
No, what are you thinking? I don't have that money with me. You don't carry those around. They look awful. Because it sounds like he's... reporting or something. Or is this some kind of mysterious, shady deal? As soon as she showed them to me, I was frightened. I told her, 'Lucretia, I don't accept that kind of money. I need normal coins.' She turned around and brought some. And ever since, I've been watching her. I've seen all sorts of things. And not just see things, but hear them too. She blasphemes the king sometimes. At other times, pays with scratched coins. And every now and then cries to other old women about how horrible the country is.
Well, she just buried her husband, you said, and her son's taken by the decade. So, she's grieving.
You're really... Your neighbor, who's always seemed like a great woman, is had some tough times and she's grieving and you're ratting her out to somebody? Come on, guy. It's such unseemly behavior. Yeah, you want to talk about unseemly behavior, nosy. I went to the bureau and they laughed in my face. As well they should. They said, 'Go complain in the market. Whores and beggars will listen to you.' Ah, and so instead of taking their advice, you're just going to try to track down someone else to get in her in trouble, huh? Do you think that that's a good joke? There's the infection I was talking about. Today they laugh about desecrating coins, and tomorrow they'll start doing it themselves. You don't look like any of this bothers you. You have no soul, you know. Think about Lucretia's son. Not the dead one, but the youngest. How can a mother like that raise him? So she lost one of her sons, she lost her husband, and now you're gonna what? Come in and mess up things for the youngest son that she's trying to raise? As she's dealing with all this grief? He has only one option now, to go to the Society for Eliminating Vice. Maybe in 7 years we'll find out that he has turned into an upstanding citizen. Wow, old man in red, maybe if you minded your own business, he'd grow into a fine upstanding citizen. All right without you, you know? You don't have to get in there and ruin everybody's life. Jeez, this guy. I'll look into it. So what are your thoughts on that, unknown man? Are you really going to look into it, or are you just saying that to, shut up, old man in red? Oliver stops in front of a skinny man with an angry, tired look. What? Okay. Oliver quickly leaves, trying not to look into the eyes of the stranger. Well, he scared you a bit, eh? Alright, you. A lavishly dressed person in red is arguing furiously. Okay, so this is what we already had. I don't want to listen to that again. Let's ask him about VF. You aren't by chance familiar with this seal. Young man, I'm familiar with every master craftsman in the city, and their seals, too. Well then, who is it? That is the stamp of Winfried Forlow. When you exit the metro, walk down to the water, and his shop is along the shore. All right. Old Winfried isn't the same as he used to be. Spent all his money, moved to a shack, and is living like a hermit. But his hands are still golden. That hasn't changed. Thank you for your help. All right. What else we got in here? Okay, we can't go that way. There we go. Who's this dapper young fella? The decade is ending, and it feels easier to breathe in the city. Don't you agree?
Probably. It was never really hard to breathe.
Ah, well, well. No doubt you're an aristocrat, and you've always been able to breathe freely, no matter what. That's the bitter truth of life. What do you mean? Well, Oliver, obviously what he means is you're an aristocrat, so you're immune to the decade. You don't have to worry about becoming ill and dying. He and probably all the people he knows do. I'm not talking about the heir. Can I ask you what you think about the Plague King's rule? Well, it seems like a dangerous question considering the conversation we just heard from Old Man in Red over there. I mean, it's not... I can't say it's really like a great thing that our king is a horrifying monster. But what else are we gonna do? It's... You know, it's not like we can... They tried to kill him before in history. It didn't work. We're stuck with him. Well, what do we say? I don't want to say he's the best. Because it sounds like this guy... Obviously, he's got a little bit of disgruntlement here. And who can blame him? You know, the lower classes have to worry about the decade. The aristocrats don't. So the aristocrats are just like, oh, whatever. It's not our problem. So, yeah, he's not going to like how things are. So he's the best, obviously. I don't want to say... If I say he's a monster, is that... It's kind of riding the line. Like, we need to be careful not to go towards the path of aberration, and I don't know, saying something against the Plague King might set us on a course of events that'll kind of... Yeah, let's do it. He's a monster. Plague King is a real monster. I don't know why he's still on the throne. Well, what else are we going to do? Yes, exactly. I'm glad that I've met by chance such a smart and caring person. Listen, I want to tell you something. Ooh? What you got? Who are the aristocrats? Don't ask me for an answer. Think for yourself. Ask yourself, and sooner or later, you'll figure out the truth. Well, careful, because I'm one of the aristocrats. Aren't aristocrats the best people? Certainly. Don't aristocrats make decisions that will help the country prosper? Again, yes. A group of aristocrats gathered together are able to make wise decisions, notwithstanding any personal goals any one of them may have individually. This is true. I'm not entirely sure I believe that. I think that's a little idealistic, but... Okay, we'll go along with you. They are geniuses, and their zeal and ability to think freely should not be limited by anything, or anyone. Oh, so you think the Plague King limits them. You probably don't know any aristocrats. They all look wonderful from afar. Yep, that's the truth there. Oliver knows. Oh, no, no, no. I know nobles. I worked as a clerk for Ashley Winsmith, and I assure you of her purity and honesty. The Winsmith family are magicians, scribes, and archivists. They're one of the most ancient and famous families in Leviathan. I don't know if I would speak of the Winsmith's honesty and purity, since they made their money selling the secrets of other aristocratic families. But this guy doesn't know that. What do you think about? Thinking about? Allow me to finish what I was saying. So, the aristocrats' ideas are able to transform the country, but only if no one tries to limit their ideas. Look, Plague King's not great. He is a monster, but what you're arguing for is not any better here, youth. And now, look at the sky where the dark clouds are swirling. Among them, you can occasionally see the top of the rotting tower. What do you see?
Excuse me?
A crude, half-mad power governs us. What authority do we have? Think of the council's lower chamber. Wonderful. Every aristocrat has the right to vote. There's also voting in the upper chamber, which is quite wonderful. The nobles take responsibility for their decisions, correct? But what happens above them, over the rule of reason, is what is so terrifying. He's there, that damned king. Just think, he's an absolutely callous, murderous creature. He will rule forever unless we can remove him by force.
We can't remove him by force. It's been tried.
Remove him, you say? You see, you're afraid. How can we put up with a ruler that only instills fear in us? In fact, the nobles themselves are to blame for him ruling over us. I thought you were just praising the nobles. Make up your mind.
You nobles are the ones who put him up there. It's time to throw him off, don't you agree? You have no concept, kid. Yes, he's a monster, but we can't fight him. He's stronger than we are, so yeah, he rules by fear. 'Cause we can't kick him out.
Well, I probably look like an idiot to everyone around me, but I would be a bigger idiot if I said out loud that I support such ideas. It's dangerous.
Well, I don't support these ideas, Oliver. Yeah, something better than the if we could have some other type of ruler than the Plague King, that would be great. But how, it doesn't seem like it's really viable. They tried it in the past. They tried to kill him. It did not happen. So we just got to deal with what we've got. And obviously this is not a guy to make an alliance with, because he doesn't understand anything either. Like, he's holding the nobles up on this pedestal. We know better. There's a lot of backbiting in there. It's not like nobles are a better option. Plague King's probably better than letting the nobles fight it out amongst themselves. Because that's what happened. If there's no Plague King, then all the nobles are going to fight about who gets to be in charge.
And if we don't do it, then he'll keep overwhelming you when you want to stop oppression. He'll poison us with the decade, snarl, break, and destroy everything. Today, just the shadow of the king defiles your authority. Who is he really? A madman who can only kill or let one go home. His reign is ending.
Listen, I can introduce you to some people. If you just believe a little of what I say.
What do you say?
I need to think about it. This sounds like a path that is going to blow up in our face. I don't think we should mess around with this guy. If it sounded like there were maybe an actual educated, organized resistance that perhaps had some kind of plan to dispose of the Plague King, I might be willing to gamble it and just see where it goes. But this guy's got no clue.
Yeah, okay, I understand. I won't pressure you. Come back if you feel like you want to help. He's unhappy with the status quo, I get that, but he doesn't actually have any sort of idea about how to fix things, so no, we don't want to get swept up in that kind of idealism. We'll leave him be.
Can I help you, sir?
I don't think you... I'm in danger.
From what? This guy?
I'm in danger. What would I be in danger from? Oh, we'll leave that be. Yeah. Guard, look over here. What can you tell me about this seal?
I'm a simple man and don't know much about emblems. Ask someone else about it, sir.
Alright. Where's the exit? Where's the exit, guard? I'm lost.
The guard points to the metro's exit. It's right there, dummy.
Go up the stairs, sir.
Yeah, alright.
Let's do it. Okay, what do we got here? Nope, nothing that side. Well, let's go here then. Oh, it's up down this one. Okay, what's... I can hear muffled voices behind the door, and sometimes women are laughing. This house is a brothel. It's one of the many public brothels that belong to the Lautners. Oh, we've got a nice view here, but nothing to click on. So there's this. Where's this go? Oh, that's back to the metro. Okay. We got here. Now, didn't they say something about...
Hey! What did I was just trying to go down. She said something...
Oh, is this the stone? She said it was hidden by...
Is this the answers?
What did we get? What did we get? A slightly damp scroll with all the history test answers. It's written with Professor Kreis's small, careful handwriting. Oh, we got him! We freaking got him. Yes. I'm really excited about that. I was just trying to, like, grab down here. I didn't... Cool. Who's this? Is that a cat fishing? A hunched over, wrinkled old creature sits on the edge of an old boat with a fishing rod in his hands. This proto-primal is a beast that looks like a small old cat, and it catches fish in the muddy water of the canal. It is a fishing cat. This thing is incredible. The White Circle is definitely not the most prosperous part of the city. There are tramps, beggars, and poor mudbloods everywhere here. And the proto-primals, of course. They can be found everywhere, though. He looks a little less cat-like this way. He's got whiskers. Like a catfish. Oliver goes down to the water and approaches the boat. The fisherman is dressed in rags and is saying something under his breath. Push him? Go away. Why would we say any of these horrible things? No, good evening. Good evening, sir. Oh, good. Well done, Oliver. Yes, for giving him the sir. We can treat this guy with some respect. Man, no reason to be rude to strangers. The proto-primal fisherman looks at Oliver with genuine surprise and fright. Oh, he's probably used to people treating him bad. He really does look like a cat. I guess he's got some cat eyes glowing there. Hello? Good evening, sir. He licks his whiskers. The proto-primal continues to fish. Let's see. We don't want to say go away. That's terrible. I'm curious who he is, but I'm afraid, like, if we're... Who are you? Then he might... You know, obviously he's a little scared of us already. It's not normal for him to have someone talk to him nicely. I don't want him to feel like we're interrogating him or threatened in any way. I guess, we'll try to go nice and easy. What's up? I'm fishing a bit, sir. I come here at sunrise and leave at sunset when I take my rod and go home. So you fish all day long? What else is there, sir? I have a litter of kittens who all need fish. He licks his whiskers. Kick the fisherman! Oh my, these... Give me your fish! He has kittens to feed! These options are so cruel. No, give the guy 5 gold. Kittens, you say? Take this money. These 5 gold will help your family. Sir, he licks his whiskers. The proto-primal fisherman blinks slowly and emotionally. It looks like he may start crying soon. Aww. Oh, see, he's not used to people being generous to him. Poor guy, he just needs a little kindness. Sir, you are a kind, generous person. I will tell my wife and kids so they will bless their food in thy name. What is your name? Oliver Vertrin. Vertrin, you say? Oliver decides to leave the fisherman alone and leaves. Well, good, we did a good deed. We helped that guy out. Okay, what do we got here? What is going... Oh, look at this guy. He's awesome. Nice. What is all of this? Oliver notices a surprisingly beautiful, finely made horn on the counter of the jeweler's workshop. Oh, jeweler. So this must be the guy. Yeah, they did say he's by the water. The instrument looks magical. It sparkles strangely somewhat on its edges. Oliver gently reaches out to touch the horn laying on the counter. Hey, Sonny, look at it, but don't you dare touch it with your hands. Do you think that I'm blind? Well, no, I wasn't going to steal it. I was just looking at it. If you try to take it, I'll kick you out no matter what aristocratic family you're from. I just wanted to look. Maybe I want to buy it. Calm down. I only want to know more about the instrument. As if that would keep you from taking it. I'm not going to take it. I don't know how this instrument can help me, but something tells me that there's a secret behind it. I might want to buy it. If we can buy it, I want to buy it. Well, want to purchase it? I do. Let's see. Well, it doesn't look cheap. If I say rare, then he's going to want to ask a lot of money. Let's just buy it. Okay, I'll take it for 10 gold. Nope. I want 30 gold for it. No, 30! If you try to bargain, I'll raise the price. Are you kidding me? Well, I would have bought the horn, but I don't have freaking 30 gold. Come on, man. Ugh. No, I won't buy it. Is that so? If you don't want it, I won't insist. Come back if you reconsider. Oh, come on, guy. I really want this horn. He said if I try to bargain, he's just going to charge more. 30. How much gold do I have? Nowhere near that. 12. Alright, you. Let's have a talk. Looking for something, Sunny. And there he is, Vinfred Forlow. I've been doing this for many years. Here in my shop, there are all sorts of treasures. Runes, rings, amulets. Choose! Well, let's take a look at him. A master jeweler is standing in front of me. He's a bald, wrinkled old man with a white beard. He's kind of a giant man, though. He's a bit imposing. He looks calm and friendly, but his eyes betray him. He has eyes of a predator. Seems like he's not that simple. I need to be careful around him. Come on, Sunny. Are you going to hang around in my shop all day? No, I didn't come here to shop. Take a look. Maybe you can tell me something about this ring? The seal is mine, but the ring itself is a forgery. It's too poorly made. A forgery, you say? Forget the damn ring. You better look here, pointing to the showcase. If you want to find the really good stuff, then you've come to the right place. If you buy two, I'll give you a discount. A big discount, Sunny. We can figure something out. We can always figure something out, my friend. No, I came here about the ring. I didn't give any indication I'd want to buy anything. The old man obviously doesn't want to talk about the ring. I bet he knows the ring is trouble, but he can't figure out why. Anyway, I have to talk to him about it, whatever the cost. Well, what are we going to do? I don't think we can pressure him. What are we going to pressure him with? Edna? No. If we try to say we're an aristocrat here, and he said he doesn't care about that. We could try to trick him. He seems like maybe kind of a crafty fellow, though. And so if we try to trick him and he catches us in it, then I think he'll just be even harder to deal with. All right, let's take a gamble. Let's just ask him straight out. Ask frankly. No, those kinds of tricks won't work here. It'd be better if I just ask him. Listen, I need only a name. Only a name. A name. Everyone needs other people's names. And me, I also need something. And really, not that much if you think about it. What? What do you need? You, I see, catch on quickly to things. I want 30 gold sa- You are stuck on 30, aren't you? Not too much for an old family secret, right? Well, it is too much. I only have 12. It's too much. You can work here until evening. You'll be like my apprentice. Bringing, fetching, getting things out of the fire. Well, alright, I can handle that. But here's the catch. Don't ask to leave before 8. It's difficult, but the secret is worth it, Sunny. If you want to know the secret, just figure out how to pay. Yeah, I'll work for you. What is it worth? There behind the shop is the entrance to the workshop. You'll polish the rubies for the necklaces. Alright. Also, I have no girly guest house, so you'll work till sunset. Got it? Okay. Got it. Well, not bad. So we're agreed? Or did you change your mind? No, I agree to work for you till evening. Let's go to the workshop. We're doing this. I like you. You do what you say. You're not a lazy parasite. I can see that. I don't know how you got the ring and don't want to know. I work and you help me. Let's go. I'll show you what to do. Oliver goes into the jeweler's closet and polishes rubies for a few hours. I guess that wasn't the best idea. Christian will flip since I'm getting in so late. Well, we needed the information. So, want to know who ordered that ring, Sunny Boy? Listen, I'll tell you what I remember. You don't mind if I write down your story, do you? Write it down, Dick. It all happened a long time ago. Those were good times, not like now. Yes, 10 years ago things were different. Don't think that I'm a grumbling old man, boy. Everything was different then. They knew me, talked about me, made orders, I had money. I had a shop, not this hole, another shop. It was near Croyston Academy, in an alley across from the archive. Oh yeah, we saw that earlier. Yeah, the closed up shop. One day I was sitting near the window working, and that bloody windsmith brought in a ring that wouldn't fit on her fat finger. She asked me to stretch it a little, grinning. I was resizing it when a carriage pulled up to the archive with some nobles in it. One of them was definitely Orvid, a rich man, his fingers in gold, his hair combed back, and a thin mustache, like them, pointing. Huh? In his description, definitely Orvid means Christian. I'm really on the right track. A woman followed. She laughed a lot, talked loudly, and seemed to be drunk. Really, really drunk. What did she look like? Was it Mom? Huh? Tall, about 30 years old, maybe less. She was beautiful, with lush brown hair. She was wearing a strange dress, but really they dress like that now, too. That's definitely Mother.
They were with another man. I knew him, yes, but I've forgotten his name. I can tell you one thing, that rascal worked as a notary. Kale's father? Damn shithead. Spitting. So they all went into the archive. They were gone for 20 minutes and then came out. It seems they had a friendly dispute. The woman yelled, "If I forget, then what?" Orvid, laughing, replied, "I've already made you a gift you can't forget. Where do women have that short of a memory?"
What did he give her?
They came into my shop. "Master," Orvid addressed me, "what do ladies receive when you want them to remember you?" "You know," I replied, "a ring. Give her a ring and she'll remember you forever." And then he ordered a ring from me. He asked me to make a ring from black silver, and the woman could choose the stone. I thought that she would want a ruby or an emerald, but she chose amber. Women are unpredictable. That's the whole story, Sonny.
Everything makes sense, but one thing. What were Christian and Mother doing in the archive? And what did he give her?
Do you remember what they said? Did Orvid say something about why they needed to go to the archive?
I think they were talking about a deal.
Yes, that's it, Sonny. You do know that copies of every document notarizing a deal should be in the archive, right? It's the law.
Got it, thank you.
Okay, so to the archive, you say.
Ah, thank you. Get out of here, Sonny. Go your way, do what you want, but don't get me involved.
As you can see, I'm in some deep shit, and if something else happens...
Alright, we'll leave you be.
So... Can we talk to this guy again?
Oh, you again, kind sir.
Well, yes, it's me.
I'm glad to see you, kind sir. Would you like to fish a bit with me?
Yeah!
Aw, I don't have time to sit here with this proto-primal.
No, maybe some other time.
We should fish with that guy for sure.
Alright, let's go to the archives then. Hit the button. Well, let's make sure nothing changed. This train is hundreds of years old, but it still looks new. These machines were built with ancient technology, and none of our specialists have been able to match their engineering. What happens if they break? Sometimes it seems that the whole city metro is controlled by some powerful magic, sorcery that we'll never figure out.
Well, let's just go then.
To the Academy station.
Alright, I think these people are all the same as their-
Do you have anything new to say to me?
Is that you, my kind helper?
It is indeed.
It's me again. Are you sure you don't know what I should do with this plaque you gave me?
No, I don't know, but I believe that the answer will come to you clearly and brightly at the very moment you need it. Just wait.
Okay, Lucille. If you say so. Not this way. Well, these weren't it. Those were...
Well, this was his used-to-be shop. And this should be Vintfred's workshop. His business was evidently a lot better before. The shop was closed and abandoned long ago. The glass is covered with thick layers of dust.
Okay, so where's the archives?
Oh, nope, this is still dangerous. We get in here. Ooh, awesome. The old man was right. This is the archive. You're so close, I can smell it. We are quite close, but... Even though we're in the archive and I'm excited to find this document and see what they were dealing with, I'm going to go ahead and wind the episode down here. I've got a little bit of a cold and I'm kind of stuffed up, so this is a lot of reading, which I do really, really enjoy, but I'm getting all sniffly and nobody wants to listen to that. So, please like and subscribe if you've enjoyed this. Come back next time. We'll see if we can find this document in the archive. We're making some progress. This is a little more... See, and Kale was so worried. Oh, all I found you was a ring. Hey, it's working out, buddy. You gave us something good to go on. We're going to get to the bottom of this.